नमस्कार नमस्कार।
या 24व्या वेबिनारमध्ये नाशिक बार असोसिएशनच्या वतीने मी आपलं सरपंच सहर्ष स्वागत करतो। आजच्या या वेबिनारचे आपले व्याख्याते आहेत श्री सुधाकर भीमराव देशमुख सर, त्यांचा थोडक्यात परिचय मी आपणास या ठिकाणी करून देतो। सरांनी बी ए मधून प्राथमिक शिक्षण घेतलं, त्यानंतर 1978 मध्ये ते LLB झाले। जिल्हा न्यायालय अहमदनगर येथे त्यांनी आपली वकिली सुरू केली आणि त्यानंतर मुंबई उच्च न्यायालयात वकिलीला सुरुवात केली। मुंबई उच्च न्यायालयात वकिली करत असताना सिव्हिल, क्रिमिनल, कोऑपरेटिव्ह, कॉन्स्टिट्युशनल मॅटर्स हे सर्व कामकाज त्यांनी त्या ठिकाणी पाहिलं आणि त्यानंतर 17/6/2003 ला मुंबई उच्च न्यायालयामध्ये ॲडिशनल जज म्हणून त्यांची अपॉइंटमेंट त्या ठिकाणी झाली आणि 2000 मुंबई उच्च न्यायालयात काम केल्यानंतर 2013 साली ते सेवानिवृत्त झाले। सर हल्ली दिल्ली येथील सर्वोच्च न्यायालयामध्ये 2015 पासून वकिली करत असून सुप्रीम कोर्टाने त्यांना सिनियर ऍडव्होकेट म्हणून डेजिग्नेट केलेलं आहे। सर दिल्ली येथे देखील आर्बिट्रेटर म्हणून ती नेमणूक इंटरनॅशनल आर्बिट्रेशन सेंटर यांनी 2015 मध्ये त्या ठिकाणी केलेली असून स्कोप फाउंडेशन दिल्ली येथे देखील सर 2016 पासून आर्बिट्रेटर म्हणून काम पाहतात आणि इंडियन लॉ इन्स्टिट्यूट ऑफ न्यू दिल्लीचे ते लाइफ मेंबर आहेत। सरांचा कायद्याचा गाढा अभ्यास आहे, त्यांच्या ज्ञानाचा आपल्याला या ठिकाणी फायदा होईल। नाशिक बारच्या वतीने मी त्यांना विनंती करतो की त्यांनी आपल्याला मार्गदर्शन करावं। देशमुख सर
हॅलो, नमस्कार। गायधरी ॲडव्होकेट गायधरी ॲडव्होकेट गोपीनाथ तिर्के जाऊ देर। हॅलो,
हा बोला सर, आवाज येते, बोला।
येते ना आवाज? ऑल पार्टिसिपंट आर प्रेझेंट।
यस सर, ऑल पार्टिसिपंट आर प्रेझेंट। ऑल ऑडियन्स आर म्युटेड सो दे कांट रिस्पॉन्स।
ओके ओके, नो प्रॉब्लेम। सो गुड इव्हनिंग टू वन अँड ऑल। The field in which all of us we are working, that is working as lawyers, is extremely relevant for human life. All courts from that viewpoint are important, and in this system we can say that judicial system, in my opinion, there are 3-4 important stakeholders. First one is the litigant for whom the system is being established. Second important stakeholder we can say are the honorable judges officiating in various courts in Indian judicial system, right from tehsil up till the honorable Supreme Court. Third and also equally important stakeholder in my view is of course lawyers who are assisting the cause of justice in all courts. This is just prelude before going to the subject which is assigned to me by the organizer. Yesterday or day before yesterday I had a talk with Advocate Sharad Gaidhani एडवोकेट गोपीनाथराव तिडके, एडवोकेट भाग्यश्री ओझा एंड सम अदर कलीग्स. इट वॉज यूनानिमस रिक्वेस्ट मेड बाय ऑल ऑफ देम. इनिशियली आई वॉज नॉट इंक्लाइंड फॉर द रीजन ऑल ऑफ अस वी आर एज ऑफ टूडे फॉलोइंग लॉकडाउन एंड रूल्स नोटिफाइड and directed to be observed by the central and various state governments. But when I was communicated by colleagues and all office bearers of the organization that this can go on without leaving our respective residence or office with the technology, I have given my consent, and all the while I was anxious for the subject. My endeavor was that the subject which is important and needs and is relevant for lawyers should be assigned to me. They have, so organizers have assigned the subject of temporary injunctions to me. This subject of temporary injunction is having utmost importance for the simple reason, if the client or litigant approaches to the lawyer at tehsil place or taluka place, and if he needs to file a civil suit, clients, as we know, they are much worried about injunction. They are coming to the lawyer of their choice and they are requesting that this is our problem and my land is being trespassed or is being encroached. I want injunction, or in our regional language, they are asking, just seek an injunction or manai hukum to the defendant or respondents. And when lawyer is trying to explain that for injunction, suit is required to be filed, immediate response from the litigant is that suit can be filed subsequently. But sir, you ask about whatever fees you are charging or expenses required for the litigation, but then see that such order, injunction order, will be granted by the court in our favor. Now this is being experienced by every lawyer, maybe whatever standing in court. Meaning thereby, if a lawyer is practicing in court for 5 years, 10 years, even up to 2 years, this scenario can be he must have faced. So this issue of injunction is not only important from the viewpoint of lawyers, but is also having utmost importance to the main stakeholder, that is the litigant. Entire system, as all of us are aware, friends, is centered around the litigant, his concern, his problems, and legal solutions which can be made available to him. So this order, this temporary injunction, is principally governed by Section 74 of Civil Procedure Code, read with Order 39, Rule 1 and 2 of Civil Procedure Code. Injunctions are granted or considered by the various courts in civil suit as well as in appellate proceeding. Even in a writ petition which is being filed before the Honorable High Court in the country. But that is not the end of the matter. When litigation ends at High Court level, still somebody is aggrieved, and that aggrieved party is approaching to a lawyer in Supreme Court for filing a writ petition, which in common parlance is called as SLP. But then same thing happens. The litigant or briefing advocate makes a request to advocate on record or to a counsel whom he has engaged to see that some interim injunction, some order will be granted in his favor by the Honorable Supreme Court. So from this viewpoint, Order 39 request to be considered. It is commonly known and called also triple test. So what is required for grant of injunction? First question. Second question, whether injunction can be granted ex parte. Third question relevant will be, what is the life of such interim order or interim injunction or injunction granted by the court? So for all these purposes, Order 39, Rule 1 and 2 is the appropriate reply. First thing, if petitioner or the plaintiff approaches to the court with a suit or whatever main purpose or main relief, he has to make separate application for temporary injunction or ad interim injunction. This temporary injunction can be sought in view of the Order 39, Rule 1 and 2. At this juncture, I would like to just read Order 39, Rule 1 for benefit of all of us. Temporary injunction and interlocutory orders. Rule 1, cases in which temporary injunction may be granted, where it is further provided, where in any suit it is proved by affidavit or otherwise that any property in dispute in a suit is in the danger of being wasted, damaged or alienated by any party to the suit or wrongfully sold in execution of a decree, or that the defendant threatens or intends to remove or dispose of his property with a view to defrauding his creditors. Subclause C of Rule 1 reads that the defendant threatens to dispossess the plaintiff or otherwise cause injury to the plaintiff in relation to any property in dispute in the suit. Further, it is provided under Rule 1 of Order 39 that the court may, by order, grant a temporary injunction to restrain such act, or make such other order for the purpose of staying and preventing wasting, damaging, alienation, sale, removal or dispossession of the property or disposition of property of the plaintiff, or otherwise causing injury to the plaintiff in relation to any property in dispute in any suit as the court thinks fit, until the disposal of the suit or until further orders. I will pause for a moment now to explain Rule number 1 of Order 39. It is amply clear that the ordinary questions or doubts raised in the mind of litigant are being answered by Order 31. That injunction, whether will be granted by the court or not, is a matter of discretion. And we can say that it is the judicial discretion of the Honorable Judge officiating the proceeding. Secondly, in which circumstances injunction can be granted, this temporary injunction can be granted in case if it is established by the plaintiff that property in dispute is in danger of being wasted. What is the danger contemplated? If the property is likely to be wasted or damaged or alienated by any party to the suit or wrongfully sold in execution of decree. So these are the circumstances in which injunction can be considered or granted by the court on the application of the plaintiff. So whole intention of Sub-Rule 1 of Order 39 is to preserve and protect the property involved in the dispute or in the suit till that dispute is decided by the court. Equally important thing is that all these things can be ascertained by the court on the basis of affidavit of the parties only. At the first instance, affidavit of the plaintiff, because many times plaintiff is the only party before the court. Defendant may not be present that time. If there is no caveat filed on behalf of defendant, only plaintiff and his lawyer, they are present before the court. Court reads the suit, application for injunction. The honorable court hears the advocate for the plaintiff. And if court is convinced that yes, the property involved in the suit is likely to be disposed of by the defendant or is likely to be damaged, or the contents of the plaintiff is that he is in possession and he is likely to be dispossessed by the other side illegally, by without following legal means, then court may consider to grant an injunction. But the material which is required is only on the basis of affidavit and public documents. Now, friends, all of you are aware, what are the public documents so far as the removal property is concerned? So if I'm a PC, court looks into record and finds the name of the plaintiff is there in 72 extract of the agricultural land. If court finds that not only name of the plaintiff is there in the occupation column of the 72 extract, but then co-op inspection column, which is most important to determine the possession of the suit property, if court finds that name of the plaintiff is also recorded there in the co-op inspection column, it leads the court that the property prima facie seems to be belonging to plaintiff because his name is appeared in 7/12 extract in occupation column. Second thing which can be inferred by the honorable court is that name of the plaintiff, which is titled in the plaint itself, is also mentioned in the co-op inspection column. The column which shows cultivation of the land is done by whom. It has got a presumption under the provisions of Maharashtra Land Revenue Code. Code gives appropriate importance to this public document. And further, court looks into affidavit of the plaintiff stating on oath that, yes, my lord, this property is owned by me. It came to me by inheritance, or I have purchased property and I have also annexed, placed on record, sale deed or the document by which I have derived title to the property. So in simple language, it can be said, prima facie court looks into public documents. Court reads the application of injunction and verifies that it is being supported by affidavit of the plaintiff. With this, court hear the advocate for the plaintiff and may consider grant of temporary injunction. But then, is it that it is obligatory for the honorable court in every case to grant injunction? Friends, it is not like that. It is a judicial discretion vested with the court. Court may, if convinced, grant ex parte temporary injunction initially for a limited period. Sometimes court may say that plaintiff is protected by temporary injunction till particular date or till further order, and then court issues notice and gives date in the matter. Order 39 contemplates that ordinarily court should not grant temporary injunction for unlimited period, because it is the experience of time that plaintiff who is able or succeeded in obtaining temporary injunction and or his lawyer may not turn to the court on next date or some other date, because they are already armed by the order of the court. And then in that case, sufferer is the defendant against whom the order of temporary injunction is running. So therefore, Order 39 Rule 1 contemplates that if court is convinced, court may grant temporary injunction initially without any period of limitation, but for some time. But court has to keep in mind that the interest of the defendant also needs to be kept in mind, protected, and after hearing defendant and plaintiff, कोर्ट में फर्दर प्रोसीड एंड फाइनली अलाउ द एप्लीकेशन और रिजेक्ट द एप्लीकेशन. दैट इज द एंड ऑफ टेम्पररी इंजंक्शन एप्लीकेशन मेड बाय द प्लेंटिफ अंडर ऑर्डर थर्टीन रूल वन एंड टू ऑफ द सिविल प्रोसीजर कोड. नाउ व्हाइल कंसीडरिंग दिस ऑर्डर 39, initially I have referred to, I said that it's a triple test which is required to be established proved by the plaintiff. Triple test means plaintiff has to establish two prima facie case in his favor. Secondly, plaintiff has to also convince the court that balance of convenience or convenience lies in favor of the plaintiff. If injunction is not granted, in that case, plaintiff will be deprived of the property or sometimes likely will be dispossessed from the property. And third, an important ingredient of injunction is that may consider that in case at this stage temporary injunction is not granted, then loss which is not reversible, or ordinarily we are what we are calling or saying irreparable loss, is likely to be there against the plaintiff. In that case, court has to consider the temporary injunction paid for by the plaintiff. If, while referring to these ingredients of the Order 39, Rule 1-2, let me share two judgments of the Honorable Supreme Court. So for grant of temporary injunction or scope of Order 13, Rule 1 and 2, there is expert injunction. The one of the leading judgments I would like to share with you, it is in the matter of Hariharanath versus State Bank of India, reported in 6 the bracket 4 AC 457. There the Honorable Supreme Court has held
हेलो
सर,
नेटवर्क इश्यू है घटते भाई. तुमचा म्यूट झालाय सर. हॅलो,
नेटवर्क प्रॉब्लेम येतो सर.
हा केला त्यांनी. हॅलो
हॅलो,
हा अनम्यूट झालो.
ठीक आहे राहता.
हा सर, थोडा सेंटरला या थोडस.
हा
चालेल.
Is it all right now?
Yes, yes, okay.
Now,
proceed.
The scope of the temporary injunction is considered by the Honorable Supreme Court in the matter of Rameshwari Devi versus Nirmala Devi within bracket 2011 bracket complete 8 SCC 249. In this case, the Honorable Supreme Court has laid down various guidelines for granting temporary injunction. The Honorable Supreme Court has further held that the court considering application for temporary injunction should be extremely careful and cautious in granting ex parte interim injunction, and ordinarily short notice should be issued to the defendants, and only after hearing the parties concerned appropriate orders should be passed. So all the while, concern of the court should be plaintiff is before the court, advocate appearing for plaintiff is also before the court, he has placed some documents along with the plaintiff of the matter, concern of the matter. But the matter about defendant, he may have to be addressed to the court. So therefore, Supreme Court says that court, while granting ex parte interim injunction, must grant it with short notice. What is the meaning of short notice? In a given case, 2 weeks notice may be a short notice. Property is scheduled by the auctioning authority 3 days after the date of filing of the suit. Court may issue notice for 1 week and may protect the plaintiff for 1 week, because court is aware that within that time auction is stayed, and defendant, if has some case and if he want to say something, he may appear before the court, he may come before the court. Point is that court, while granting injunction, also has to take into account interest of the defendant, may grant injunction, but then with short notice, and after return of that notice, court should hear both the parties and then only pass further orders, either granting injunction, making it conform till dispose of the suit, or for whatever order court feels proper in the fact situation of the case. Now with this, I will just proceed further. The court, Supreme Court, has time and again said that court has to grant ex parte injunction in exceptional cases, because while granting injunction, only one party, that the plaintiff, is before the court, but then injunction should not be in blanket form or without assigning reason. Earlier I said that it is a judicial discretion of the court, but then that discretion also seems to be there on record. While granting injunction, court must record a reason that yes, I have gone through the plaint, I have seen the affidavit, I have also considered that document of title, sale deed, is placed on record by the plaintiff, wherein the property in dispute is mentioned, and it appears that said property has been purchased by registered sale deed by the plaintiff with some consideration. So in short, court has to record its satisfaction in order. Why court is convinced? Why court is granting ex parte injunction? And then there is no difficulty, court can grant injunction with short notice. That is what the Supreme Court has laid down. Next case, now I would like to lay my hand. That is by virtue of the law laid down by the Honorable Supreme Court in the case of Makers Development Services Private Limited versus M. Vishwacharya Industrial Research and Development Center, reported within bracket 2012, bracket complete 1 SCC 735. Here, the court has in clear terms said that three basic principles are propounded by the Honorable Supreme Court, that is prima facie case, balance of convenience, and irreparable injury or loss likely to be caused to the plaintiff. Now the further case I would like to refer to is that the court, while passing order at the interim stage or temporary stage, must keep in mind that no final order can be passed, because it is the interim stage only. Evidence is not recorded. Other side is not before the court. So it is not for the court to pass a final order, because that will be final, will be a decree in the suit or in the proceeding, final order, not at this interim stage. This principle is laid down by the Honorable Supreme Court in the matter of Vishnu Tambe versus Apurva Tambe, reported within packet 2017, packet complete 2 SCSC 454. It is further important to notice that final relief, which is sought by the plaintiff, cannot be granted by the court at interim stage and by means of interim order. For the proposition, this proposition has been laid down by the court, Supreme Court, in the matter of BSNL, that is Bharat Sanchar Nigam Limited versus Prem Chandra Premi, within bracket 2005, bracket complete 13 SCC 505. With this, I would like to now refer to section 41 of the Specific Relief Act. This section is important from the viewpoint that temporary injunction is not the remedy for all illegalities, for all problems, or for all illegal acts of the defendant. If appropriate remedy is available, that is called as efficacious remedy is available to the party concerned, and more specifically to the plaintiff, then court must ask plaintiff to avail that property, that remedy, go to that forum, seek remedy there. If there is no remedy, then only court may proceed with the application and consider the application for temporary injunction. So section 41H is the section of Specific Relief Act which talks about the grant of injunction. With this, now this limited topic which was allotted for today's lecture, I would like to wind up. But then while proceeding further or saying anything, let me share one or two anecdotes with you. In court, more specifically in trial courts where trial is going on, many anecdotes, very many events do happen. And there is sometimes some humor also in those events. Such events are happening everywhere across the globe, not only in Indian courts, but some other courts are also. I came across a case of wills. Two persons, Daniel Webster and Rufus, were contesting a case of will. Both parties were from Springfield, Massachusetts, USA. Daniel was seeking relief in his favor. He was saying that will is in his favor. And the other side, Rufus, he was trying to break the will. According to him, will is not the real or person the person who made it. He wanted to say that will was a forged document made after the demise of the person concerned. So Rufus, in the course of argument before the court, he said that, my lord, this will is of a dead hand. He he wanted to convey to the court that this will was not executed by the deceased person during his lifetime. Daniel heard this and replying this, he said to the court that it is not the fact. He tried to convince the court that the will is the last will of the person, deceased person, when he was alive. And that is how witnesses before the authority were present and have vouched it. So while working in the court, such events are also happening, which may keep the course of the cause alive. It is not only the pleadings or the fight of paper tigers. So with this, now Sharad and Gopinath Tikya, I am not able to see him, but Sharad, you are there.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So with this, let me conclude that today's subject I have tried to address whatever was possible with short time with me. Friends, I would like to seek your permission.
Sir, वेळ आहे तर तुम्हाला काही शेअर करायचं असेल काही जजमेंट्स किंवा स्पेसिफिक वर्क किंवा आणखी काही थोडंफार मॅन्डेटरी इंजंक्शन्स वगैरे वगैरे तर यू कॅन हॅव
सेक्शन 94 सी अँड ई वरती पण आपल्याला बोलता येईल अजून
बरोबर आहे म्हणून मी सुरुवातीला त्याचा उल्लेख केला मी आणि 94 सी खालचे जजमेंट आहेत बॉम्बे हायकोर्टचे आहेत सुप्रीम कोर्टचे पण आहेत देर इज अ डिफिकल्टी अँड सो फार मेंटल इंजेक्शन आर कन्सर्न त्याच्यावर सुद्धा बोलण्यासारखं आहे ती आपली वेळ
आपल्याला वेळ आहे अजून सर अजून अर्धा तास आहे आपल्याकडे
हरकत नाही परंतु जे मटेरियल त्यांच्यासाठी माझ्याकडे कंपॅरिझन पाहिजे
ओके
राईट नो दॅट कंपॅरिझन इज नॉट विथ मी
अच्छा ओके ओके सर विथ युअर परमिशन कॅन वी गो फॉर क्वेश्चन आन्सर सेशन
नाउ नो प्रॉब्लेम आय हॅव नो प्रॉब्लेम
वन क्वेश्चन इज आस्क्ड बाय वन ऑडियन्स what is the life of the interim order when it is not mentioned in the order?
So far, life of interim of order is concerned. Most of the time, that life is mentioned in the order itself. But sometimes it happens that court has granted interim injunction and sufferer is the defendant. But then in that case, sub-rule 3 or 4 of CPC that permits the defendant to make an application for vacating an interim injunction. So that application required to be heard by the court and that will bring the issue to an end either way. Court will be convinced, court may vacate the injunction and if not convinced, the court after hearing both the parties may confirm the injunction. Reply to that query is only rule 3 or rule 4. Right now that CPC is not with me. I'm talking from my residence. That book is not with me. If book is with any lawyer present there in audience, he may read that rule 3 or 4 or all of, for benefit of all of us. If you are having CPC, take out rule 3 or 4. Order 39, rule 3 or 4. Four or six.
Just a minute, sir.
Please read.
Before granting injunction, court to direct notice to opposite party.
please read further. Read further. Read that rule 3, 4, and 6.
Three is going to say that the court shall, in all cases except where it appears that the object of granting the injunction would be defeated by the delay, before granting an injunction, direct notice of the application for the same to be given to the opposite party, provided that where it is proposed to grant an injunction without giving notice of the application to the opposite party, the court shall record the reasons for its opinion that object of the granting the injunction would be defeated by delay and required the applicant. Subpara A, to deliver to the opposite party or to send to him by registered post immediately after the order granting the injunction has been made, a copy of the application for injunction together with a copy of the affidavit filed in support of the application, a copy of the plaint, and a copy of document on which the applicant relies, and to file on the day on which such injunction is granted, on the day immediately following that day, an affidavit stating that the copies aforesaid have been so delivered or sent.
Now rule 5 or 6 that says that defendant can make an application for vacating in the injunction. Order 39.
Just a minute, sir.
Defendant can make an application for vacating interim injunction. That is either rule 4, 5 or 6. Order 39.
Me screen varthi dakhavto order.
Haan.
Order 39, rule 4, na?
4, 5 or 6. That gives liberty to the defendant to make an application for vacating interim injunction.
Okay, just I'm bringing it on screen now.
Please. Bring it on screen.
Can you read it now?
Rule 1 is there only.
Oh, now, order 39, rule 4 is on screen now.
Right. Yes. So, proviso. Now, I will read for all of us. Provided further that where an order for injunction has been passed after giving to a party an opportunity of being heard, the order shall not be discharged, varied, or set aside on the application. So, rule 1 is the important. 39, rule 4, 1. Any order for an injunction.
Is it correct? Temporary injunction and interlocutory order.
Rule 4-1. Any order for an injunction may be, right? No, 4-1.
After the words by...
These are amendments. 4-1. Yes, provided that if in an application for temporary injunction or in an affidavit supporting such application, a party has knowingly made a false or misleading statement in relation to a material particular and the injunction was granted without giving notice to the opposite party, the court shall vacate the injunction unless, for reasons to be recorded, it considered that it is not necessary to do so in the interest of justice. Provided further that where an order for injunction has been passed after giving to a party an opportunity. Now, subrule 1 is important. It says that if subrule 1, 4, 1, 39, 4, 1,
there is injunction is also in section order 39, rule 4.
Right, 4-1.
41 is not appears to be there. There are only two proviso, and then amendment is there.
So 41 is there. 41 you can read, provided that.
Hi, Eka. Provided that if any stage of the suit.
Right. That is. That is. So close to provided that if at any stage of the suit it appears to the court that the party in whose favor the order of injunction exists is dilating the proceeding or is otherwise abusing the process of court, it shall set aside the order for injunction. So this provision can be put into place by the defendant. Defendant may come with an application for variation. Defendant may say that this fact was suppressed or not brought before the court when expert injunction was ordered, was granted, obtained by the plaintiff. So with the aid of this rule, defendant may apply to the court for vacating interim injunction granted by the court. And in that case, court has to hear both the parties and proceed further.
Sir, next question is that what is the difference between status quo and order of injunction?
It's a good question. Injunction many times granted by the court, and it is in clear terms saying that don't disturb possession of the plaintiff or don't alienate the property. So for status quo is concerned, very thin difference is there. Status quo means as of today, whatever is the position obtaining existing regarding suit property, maintain that as it is. It is also virtually injunction, but couched in different words. But then it becomes debatable and disputable, because so far as the status quo is concerned, plaintiff may say that he is in possession if standing sugarcane crop is there. Plaintiff may say that I have planted this sugarcane crop. Defendant may say that I have planted this sugarcane crop. So all that, such orders are passed when some party says that sugarcane crop is likely to be harvested. And in that case, the payment will be taken away by one party. So therefore, many times courts are passing order, maintain status quo. That means as of today, crop is standing in the field, in the land. Let it be there only. After some time, we'll decide who has planted sugarcane, who has put in expenses, who has watered the crop, and who is entitled to take the crop. So court says that as of today, if crop is there, maintain that crop as it is, don't harvest it, neither by not to be harvested by the plaintiff, not by the defendant. And that is what the court status quo they are meaning. So status quo is in that way a very broad meaning word. So for that purpose, one must know what is the existing position. Then only you can come to a conclusion that what status quo to maintain. It becomes a question to be determined by the court in due course of time. So that is the thin line between status quo and temporary injunction or interim injunction. Any other question?
Further question?
Okay, sir, any other question?
ज्यावेळेस काही दाव्यांमध्ये असं होतं की अंतरिम अर्जात इंटरिम ऍप्लिकेशन मध्ये जी मागणी केलेली असते ती मूळ दाव्यातच केलेली नसते, फायनल प्रेयर तशी नसते, त्यावेळेस त्याचं काय?
अंडरस्टूड, आय एम कमिंग टू दॅट. यू सी दॅट होल ऑब्जेक्ट ऑफ ऑर्डर 39 इज टू ग्रँट सम प्रोटेक्शन इन फेवर ऑफ द प्लेंटिफ टू प्रोटेक्ट द प्रॉपर्टी. इफ इनिशियली आय सेड दॅट इफ फायनल रिलीफ is not prayed or cannot be granted, both circumstances can be there. When final relief is not prayed for, then there is no question of granting interim injunction, interim relief. Second, if final prayer cannot be granted by the court, I will give an example. If suit is filed for agricultural land, GERT number 105, and permanent injunction is asked for in final relief, in that suit, temporary injunction, that plaintiff is in possession and don't disturb possession, can be considered by the court. But if interim application is filed without pleading, that restraint dependent from selling or disposing of the property, then that cannot be granted for the simple reason to restrain from alienating selling property is not the final leave asked for in the suit. So therefore, if final leave cannot be granted or not sought for, interim injunction also cannot be granted. Very simple proposition. Any other question?
Yes, sir. पुढचा प्रश्न असा विचारलाय की वादीने काउंटर क्लेम न करता प्रतिवादीने काउंटर क्लेम न करता त्याला वादीला वादीच्या विरुद्ध मनाईहुकूम मागता येईल का?
काउंटर क्लेम न करता
वादीच्या विरुद्ध प्रतिवादीला मनाईहुकूम मागता येईल का?
तो विषय जो आहे अगेन इट गोज बॅक टू सेक्शन 94 ऑफ सीपीसी
राईट
94 सी
सी एंड ई
C and D. So in that case, if case is fits in, he can. So that the tumhala case basvata aali prativad dila, tar tumhala magta yeil. Par mag te matra 39(1)(2) khali nahi. Te mool section 74, tyacha khali tumhala 94, 94 tyacha khali magta yeil. अजून काय कुठला प्रश्न?
पुढचा प्रश्न विचारलेला आहे की ऑर्डर 39 रूल 3 चा जो कंप्लायन्स करायचा असतो मनाईहुकूम मिळाल्यानंतर तो किती मुदतीमध्ये करायचा आहे?
ऑर्डरली तो दॅट इज 15 डेज दॅट मेंशन केलेलं आहे ते ऑर्डर 39 रूल 3 मध्ये. आणि त्याच्या रजिस्टर पावत्या असतात ना पोस्ट पावत्या रजिस्टर केल्या त्या 25 टू प्लेस ऑन रेकॉर्ड दॅट रिसीट अलॉंग विथ ऍफिडेव्हिट दॅट आय हॅव कंप्लाइड विथ दी रूल 3. And if it's not done, defendant can ask for vacating interim injunction because it is a breach of order passed by the court.
पुढचा प्रश्न विचारला whether there is an automatic vacation of the interim order after 6 months as per the recent judgment. Is it correct, sir?
Recent judgment of which court?
That is not given by the audience.
That is very irrelevant because judgment of the Honorable Supreme Court lays law which is binding for all courts in country. If it is judgment of the Supreme Court, then different thing, then no one can say no. But if it is the judgment of some other tribunal or forum, we cannot comment upon it.
There is another question, whether court can grant ex parte injunction order against government without issuing notice.
For that purpose, section 80 is there, 80. If suit is filed against government or officer of the government, party has to issue notice under section 80 to that government officer and government, or not notice is not issued, then seek leave of the court, file a suit and seek interim relief, no difficulty. You have to comply with section 80 or seek the liberty from the court.
Pudcha prashna
ajun kai
in a there is a suit for partition filed along with TI that bar of section 52 transfer of property act thereafter suit property. I think this is a personal question. Skipping it. Next question is, can one co-owner claim injunction against another co-owner for not to dispossess him from suit property of which he is in exclusive possession?
Principally, no injunction can be sought by one co-owner against another co-owner, but then in a given case, if facts are there, it's a different matter altogether, but principally no. So the injunction cannot be granted against the co-owner.
Next question, whether possession of party is legal or not is a vital element while deciding TI application.
Now that is also a relevant question. While coming to a conclusion that plaintiff has prima facie case and possession, that possession ordinarily has to be legal possession. And there may be something placed on record to show that possession is legal possession. So illegal possession cannot be protected by the court.
Thank you, sir.
To convince the court that, yes. So it is over. Okay, Mr. Gopiraj, okay, thank you. Somebody is asking some pseudo partition.
I hand over the virtual platform to Mr. Gaidani, sir. Gaidani, sir, please.
Yes, sir. Okay. धन्यवाद सर.
सर आपण काय हरकत नाही. मला माहित नाही मी जे काय म्हणालो होते बट तुमच्यापर्यंत कन्व्हे झालं की नाही आणि तुम्हाला कसं वाटतं मला माहित नाही. पण आपला जो थोडा वेळ मला थोड्या वेळेमध्ये मला जे सांगता येईल सारखे मी सांगायचा प्रयत्न केला.
हो सर.
Right, sir. During this pandemic, we have some limitations. You don't have books or notes along with you. We understand the difficulties.
Right. And I cannot go to my office also for that purpose.
Okay. Right, sir.
Okay. Sadhya, thank you.
Sadhyacha kaalamadhe Supreme Court-acha virtual work suru zalela aahe. Apan ते आपल्याला त्यामुळे त्या ठिकाणी दोनच दिवस या ठिकाणी आधी आम्ही सांगितलं आणि आपण त्या वेळेत देखील आपण आमची विनंतीला मान दिला आणि इंजंक्शन तसा अवघड विषय आहे त्या विषयावर आपण या ठिकाणी विथ स्पेसिफिक रिलीफ ऍक्ट आपण मार्गदर्शन करण्याचं मान्य केलं आणि आज आपल्याला या 24th वेबिनारमध्ये आम्हाला संपूर्ण तमाम महाराष्ट्रातील किंवा सर्व बघणाऱ्या वक्त्यांना अतिशय छानपैकी मार्गदर्शन केलं त्याबद्दल मी आपलं नाशिक बार असोसिएशनच्या वतीने आणि सर्व वकील बंधूंच्या वतीने या ठिकाणी आभार मानतो आणि आजचं 24th वेबिनार या ठिकाणी संपन्न झालं असं सर्वांच्या वतीने या ठिकाणी जाहीर करतो. धन्यवाद.
तुम्हा सर्वांना भरपूर शुभेच्छा आणि तुम्हाला कधी काही अडचण वाटली तुम्ही मला कधी संपर्क करू शकता आणि जे काय मला करणं शक्य आहे कुणासाठी आणि विशेषतः सगळ्यांसाठी मी कधी तयार आहे. यू कॅन कॉन्टॅक्ट मी. तुम्ही मला कधी संपर्क करा मला जे शक्य असेल ते मी कायदा प्रयत्न करेन. चला
धन्यवाद सर.
आभारी आहे.